بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم.
عليكم السلام.
We have for those people who are coming for the first time, this gathering we have on every month on one Saturday, where we discuss the principles of our faith on a bit higher scale. Not only that which we are taught in madrasas, or what we teach our boys in madrasas and girls, but on a bit higher scale, going into some details. For example, for the last several months, we were discussing Tawheed, the concept of oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as understood by Islam, taught by Ahlul Bayt sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, we completed that, and we last time we said that we are now going to enter into the next subject, which is Adl Ilahi. Now, because it is a subject which has got a lot of problems, a lot of questions, a lot of objections, a lot of differences among the Muslims, and even laymen, when they think of justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they do have many questions in their minds, and it is not very simple to answer those questions just straight away like that. A lot of background has got to be maintained and understood and explained before Adl Ilahi, as it is understood, justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After that, of course, we keep our session open for questions and answers on the subject, and of course for any other fiqh or masail that people may want to ask. Now, there must be first a clarification that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away after his wafat, up to the time of say 60 Hijrah, that means about 50 years. That means the first half of the first century was over, and they were entering into the second half of Hijrah. The Muslims came into contact with so many thinkers of non-Muslim origin. They came into contact with so many other civilizations. They came into contact with so many other ideas and ideologies. Some of them were directly attacking Islam. Because they were attacking the precepts of Islam, the ulama among them started a class or a group of ulama which were called people of kalam. Kalam means ilmul kalam, means discussing theology, discussing aqaid, that means tawheed, the manner of tawheed, the meaning of oneness of Allah, sifat and dhat. And also there came a stage where they started discussing Adl Ilahi. Now, when they began to discuss Adl Ilahi, two major groups arose from among Muslims. One thing I must make it very clear, that no Muslim is against Adl Ilahi as such. No Muslim. It is not right to say that Sunni Muslims do not believe that Allah is Adil. No, it's not right. They believe in Adl Ilahi. The only difference is in the interpretation of Adl, because they could not have disbelieved in Adl Ilahi. The Quran and Majid is so open about it. Inna Allah laysa bidhallamin lil abid. Allah is not a tyrant or unjust to his servants, that means to his people. Inna Allah la yadhlimu mithqala dharratin. Quran says, Allah does not do injustice, even atom weight. Means these are open ayah, so they could not have said that Allah is not Adil. But what happened was that there were two big, very big groups. One was led by Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari. And the followers of Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari are called Ash'aris or Asha'ira. This man had a very great following, many ulama and students. He held, his belief was, that Adil, now because I'm talking, as I said, we are discussing our principles on a higher level. We are not discussing principles as we teach our children. And mashallah, intelligent people are sitting here, you will be able to understand. I'm setting a background, a backdrop, against which we will be discussing very complex subjects related to Adil later, inshallah. What he said was that Adalat is not a reality. It is not something which exists, as they call, as a truth. It is not a truth which exists without being supported by evidence. There are many things which are truths and they require no evidence. Day is a day. There's no need for dalil for that, for example. Or let us take in morals. To steal is bad. Now that doesn't require any dalil or any evidence. To be truthful is good. To be helpful to elderly person is good. To lead a blind man is good. I mean, these things do not require dalil. What are called maxims or certain axiomatic truths, truths which require no evidence. He says that adalat is not anything which remains independent. He says it is not absolute, it is relative. What is the meaning of that? I'll explain. What is the meaning of that? The meaning of anything being relative is in Arabic called nisbati. That means something may be good in this society. It may not be good in another society. Something must have been good 10 years ago. It's not good today. Something is expected or accepted in certain society as very malign and very bad and evil. In our society it is good. So he says that it is nisbati. And therefore adalat is not a truth. Now having said this, it's not a truth in itself. It's not an absolute truth. It has got no mustatil or haqiqat in itself. It is relative. Therefore, his argument was, and mark the words. The words were that whatever Allah does is adil. That means Allah does not do according to adil. Whatever he does is adil. Do you understand the difference? That means he is the all in all, he is the master. And if he decides, he said this in very open words, if he decides to send a mu'min to Jahannam, it will be adalat. And if he decides to send a kafir to Jannah, it will be adal. Because adil to him depended not as an absolute reality independent of Allah, but it is Allah who decides what is adil. Now in his group, this is called, they are adil, they are also believing in adil, but this is a type of adil. In Farsi they say, Unche khusru kunat shirinas. Whatever the king does is good and sweet. So this is what he believed. Then among the students, there were certain ulama who left him because they did not agree with him in this principle. They didn't agree with him. those who left him are called Mu'tazila. I'tizal means to pull away, to go away, to abandon. And that is the reason why they are called Mu'tazilin. Mu'tazila are those who left him. Men like Wasil bin Atta and others, they left him. And they pronounced another theory, which is that Adl or justice is a reality itself. It is a self-evident truth. And Allah acts according to that. It is haqiqah, mustaqil. It is an absolute. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being wise, hakim, being qadir, omnipotent, being wise and qadir, does what adl says. So now putting it into very simple words. There is one thing which says, kullama hakama bihi al-aql, hakama bihi al-shara. Whatever aql says, shariat follows. There is one which says, kullama hakama bihi al-shara, hakama bihi al-aql. Whatever shariat says, aql will follow. Now there are two schools, and in these two schools there is a lot of variation. In this first one, the Asha'ira, they believe that Allah can do whatever He like, and whatever He does will be adl. He can send a kafir to Jannah. He can send a mu'min to Jahannam, and that will be adl. Right. Now before, as they went on discussing this and debating this, one subject came in between. You see, the subject pulls through another subject. Is a man a free agent or not? Fa'il muhtar or majboor? Is a man, when he acts, does he act of his own will? Does he have a free will? Or he does not have a free will? Asha'ira, because they said that whatever Allah does is according to adl, is adl, and not what adalat says is what Allah will do, they then had to. There was no other recourse. They had to pronounce this theory that a man is not a free agent. A man is majboor. Because whatever he has to do, Allah has destined. And Mu'tazila said that man is a free will, free agent, an animal who can exercise his own irada and will when he acts. From this stood up another one, that either a thing is good, is it inherently good? That means when something is said to be good, is it good in itself, bhati, or is it good relatively? And when something is bad, is it dhati or is it relative? And again, we differed with them. Asha'ira said that husn and qubh, that is ugliness and goodness or evil of any act, is not dhati. It is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to steal is haram, therefore it is bad. It is because Sharia says to speak truth is good, therefore it is good. And we said, together with Mu'tazila, that no, it is not so. Because to speak untruth and to speak lies is inherently, in itself, bad. Therefore Allah has ruled that it is bad. And because speaking good, truth, is good in itself, dhati, therefore Allah has ruled itself. Therefore, goodness and evil is aqli, according to Mu'tazila. And this is the school of thought of Mu'tazila, which was governed and ruled by the teachings of Ahlul Bayt, salamullah alayhi ajma'een, except that there are some differences where we don't agree with Mu'tazila that will come later. The problem was that the moment Asha'ira came with this particular point that everything that Allah says and Sharia says is good, nothing is good otherwise, they immediately said, we say this because we rely on Sunnah and Hadith and things like that. So they started calling themselves Ahlul Sunnah and Ahlul Hadith. Because they came with the name of Sunnah and Hadith, the public started accepting them more than Mu'tazila. Because then Mu'tazila were automatically defined as opposed to Sunnah, opposed to Hadith, while it was not true. And that is the reason why Mu'tazila lost ground once and for all. You will hardly find anyone today calling himself a Mu'tazili. Because they were branded as being opposed to Sunnah and Hadith. This was a political game, which was of course very successfully played. But if you see today, there is no one who is calling himself a Mu'tazili. But what Ahlul Bayt Salamullah alayhim ajma'in have said, and what Aimma Salamullah in those days said, is exactly what Wasil bin Attar preached. It went in the name of Mu'tazil. It has stayed today because of Ahlul Bayt and because of the Shayyu. Now, I must explain what is the meaning of Adala as far as we are concerned. Adala makes Tawheed complete and gives meaning to Nubuwwah, Imamat and Qiyam. Therefore we put it in Usul al-Din. It is true that Usul al-Din are three: Tawheed, Nubuwwah and Ma'ad, Qiyam. But we had to put Ma'ad at Adl there to give full meaning to Tawheed and to give full meaning to Nubuwwah, Imamat and Qiyam. I will explain. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, na'uzu billah, as they believe, forces me to drink, forces me to commit a sin, I have no free will, then the meaning of Adab and the meaning of Jahannam is redundant. If he forces me to pray and to fast because he has destined, then to give me Jannah is meaningless. Understood? One day, Imam Abu Hanifa, who is the, we must know this, that Abu Hanifa is known as Nu'man bin Thabit. He was an Iraqi Arab, Kufi. Some of them even don't call him an Arab, they call him Ajami because he was not of Arab origin. But he is Imam-e-A'zam, which means Sunnis have got four A'imma, and the greatest and the first Imam is Abu Hanifa. He once came to see Hazrat Imam Jafar Sadiq salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi, and when he came there, Imam alayhi salam was busy in the house. He sat there, he saw a young boy with a small goat, young animal goat, playing with it. He asked, who is this boy? Somebody said, Huwa Musa ibn Ja'far. He is the son of Imam Ja'far Sadiq. His name is Musa ibn Ja'far. Abu Hanifa drew near and thought about the boy at that time, Imam alayhi salam, in his childhood, was actually trying to pull the head of the goat and tell the goat, do sajda. I mean, the way children play with animals, keeping his hand on the head of the animal, telling him, usjud bi rabbik, do sajda for your creator. It was a game which of course amuses people, elderly people, to see a man or young boy taking an animal to tell him usjud li rabbik. He came closer and he first tested Imam alayhi salam in a different way. He first said, oh son, if a stranger comes here and he wants to go to urinate, to toilet, there was no toilet those days, people went out or they had secluded places. He said, if a stranger came out here and if he wanted to relieve himself of urine, where should he go? So Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, a child at that time, said, Ya Shaykh, you must go to a place where you don't sit before Qibla and do not keep your back opposed to Qibla. And you must see that the wind is not blowing hard, and you must not sit under the tree bearing fruits, and the ground must not be hard, and the people must not be seeing you, and it must not be in an alley where people residing there do not like you to do it. Find a place where you can be hidden and relieve yourself. When he heard this, he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone knows where to keep risalat. The young boy telling him all the masail which relate to mustahabbat and muharramat of even passing water. Then he asked him, he said, then let me ask you one more question. Now he knew. He said, may I ask you one thing? Is a man a free agent or not? Is he majboor, as Ash'ari says, or is he free, as your father Ja'far Sadiq says? So all the elders were sitting there, and now Imam alayhi salam in his childhood says, Ya Shaykh, there are only three things, there can't be fourth. See, three situations. Either a man does it of his own free will, or Allah forces him, or it is 50-50. There can't be a fourth thing. It's either a man doing alone as a free will agent, or he is being forced by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or half of it comes from God and half of it comes from self. Can you imagine of any fourth situation? Abu Hanifa said, no, these are only three I can. He said, now look, if he has forced 50-50, then he must share the adab 50-50 and also the jaza 50-50. Otherwise it will not be fair. And if he has forced me to do, then I should not be punished or rewarded. The only alternative, if you believe in Qiyamah, Jannat and Jahannam, is to believe that a man does it himself. So when he heard this, he said, well, I had come for the same purpose. Now if I don't meet Imam Ja'far Sadiq, it is enough, because I am satisfied with this. So this is what we believe in, that Tawheed is not complete because so much of Aib, so much of unnecessary imputations will go to, in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as a zalim, na'udhu billah, and as many other things. Why? There are four arguments. Please listen to this very carefully, what our ulama have said. If Allah does something qabih, qabih means undesirable, vulm, ugly, whatever is imputed to him that he can do, he may have done this, then there are four things which can be taken into consideration. Either he does it knowingly, or he does it unknowingly, or he does it by force, or he does it playfully. Again, either he does it knowing full well that he is doing qabih, or he is doing without knowing that it is qabih, or he is doing because he has been forced to do it, or he is doing it playfully, abath. Is there any fifth one? You can imagine in our lives also, if I do something qabih, something ugly, good, whether it is makruh or gunah kabira, na'udhu billah, either I am doing it knowing that it is gunah, or I am doing it not knowing that it is gunah, or somebody is forcing me to do it, or I am just doing it playfully, purposelessly. Three things, four things. Now, the answer is, if Allah does it knowingly, then he is a zalim. If he does it unknowingly, then he is jahil. If he is done by force, he is muhtaj. And if he does it playfully, then he is not hakim. Because Allah says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have a purpose. And there's one thing he said, أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا وَأَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْنَا لَا تُرْجَعُونَ. Do you think that I have created you purposelessly? So abath is not there. But how many things go in the name of God? Jahalat, astaghfirullah, zulm, ihtiyaj. Only if you agree that Allah can do something which is qabih, or something which is bad, or something which is unreasonable. Therefore, Tawheed is completed by Adalat. That's why we put Adalat there. And it is the Adalat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which made it necessary to send a Nabi, to send Imam, and then finally, after having received the accountabilities from us all, to reward or to punish. This, without Adalat, Usul al-Din does not become meaningful. That is why Adalat is a fulcrum on one side is Tawheed, on the other side are the other principles of our faith. And that is why Adl is very important. Now, having said this, Amir al-Mu'min salawatullahi wa salam said something in Arabic. In Najib al-Agha it is there. Unfortunately, the charm and the sweetness and the beauty in what he said cannot be conveyed in the translation. In Arabic, there are certain expressions where similar letters are used with different meanings, makes language beautiful. Same letters are used with different meaning and makes it very beautiful. For example, in Surah Yusuf, there is when Yaqub says, Ya Asafa ala Yusufa. Asafa has got seen and fair, and Yusuf also has got seen and fair. Ya Asafa ala Yusuf. Ya Asafa means, oh, wail, cry upon my Yusuf. Allah has used the word with similar letters. And this beauty cannot be conveyed in other language. There are so many other in Quran and Majid where Allah, وَالْتَفَّتِ السَّاقَ بِالسَّاقَ وَإِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ يَوْمَئِذِنِ الْمَسَاقِ. When people die, sometimes we rub our ankle against an ankle. وَالْتَفَّتِ السَّاقَ بِالسَّاقَ وَإِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ يَوْمَئِذِنِ الْمَسَاقِ. And on that day you will be driven to your God. This masaq is to drive, and that saq is ankle. Allah uses similar letters, but for different words. This is called one aspect of fasahat of Arabic of Quran, which can only be understood in its original. We cannot convey it in English. Amir al-Mu'minin al-Islam says, At-Tawheed, an la tatawahama. وَالْعَدْلُ أَنْ لَا تَتَّهِمَ. Now, how can I translate this? التوحيد أَنْ لَا تَتَّوَهَّمَ. Tawheed means he should not come into your conjecture. But عَدْل is أَنْ لَا تَتَّهِمَ. The عَدْل is that you must not be in a position to accuse him of anything. Now, hey meme has been used twice, tatawahima and tatahima. But you see, this is Arabic. And this is Kalamul Imam, Imamul Kalam, which we cannot translate, but the translation is there, but we cannot bring that beauty into translation. But although Amir al-Mu'minin al-Islam says, Tawheed is that he does not come in our guesswork, he cannot be encompassed in our imagination. And Adl is that no accusation will ever be made. The moment one accuses him, that means he has not understood Adl. So now, there are 9 things. With this, I will complete this. And I want you to think of this. It does not complete the subject. I have only introduced it. There are questions I know you have in mind. But let us wait when I have explained everything in the coming 3 or 4 sessions. InshaAllah ta'ala, then you ask me questions. Because there are questions like, Mullah sahab, why people are dying of hunger? Mullah sahab, why is someone born disabled? Mullah sahab, why is there no fair distribution of wealth? Why is someone poor? Why is someone suffering? There are so many things you will ask. But let us first understand. The subject has got to be introduced. I have introduced. If we jump up, then of course the introduction will die. We are here still, as I have insisted always, that we are sitting here as students. Most of you are my guests today. If you will sit on every Saturday, inshallah, you will get so much to learn from Ahlul Bayt salamullahi alayhi wa sallam, that you will be surprised that we have gone so deep into this. We are not superficial. Of course, there was a time in madrasa when it had to be superficial. Member had to be superficial because member caters for people of various strata. But when we sit like this, we have got to understand that we have got our faith and aqidah, which is deep rooted in intellect, reason, and we cannot be defeated by any philosophers even today. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Right? The first thing that is the meaning of adalat is Inna Allah Ta'ala Adilun fi makhluqatihi غير ظالم له أو به. First thing is this, the meaning of عدالت is that Allah is for us all who are His creation a just creator, a just master. Never, never does anything unjust. Second, لا يفعل قبيحا. Nothing unreasonable, ugly, nothing bad can ever come from him. وَلَا يَخْلُ لِوَاجِبْ. And whatever is necessary, he does not fail to do it. The reason why our ulama say is that this cap is mine. It is mine. That cap is yours. That cap is yours. Right? Is it adl to keep it here and wear it here? It is yours. You are malik of it. But will you say it is all right to keep it here? But if you argue that it is my property, wherever I keep it is adl, will it be accepted? It will not be accepted. So that is why the ulama have given a very good description saying ظلم means وضع الشيء على غير محله. To keep a thing on a place which does not belong to it is ظلم. Allah does not do this. Although He is the master, but the master does not do that which is kabir, which is ظلم. Therefore He cannot say muti'een or those who obey to Jahannam. وَلَهُ, this is very important what ulama have written, وَلَهُ أَنْ يُعَاقِبَ الْعَاصِينَ. And it is for him, if he so desires, to punish those who go disobeying. And that means that there is an option to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he may even forgive. When he forgives by grace and fadl. If he does not forgive, then he gives punishment. وَلَا يُكَلِّفُ الْخَلْقَ مَا لَا يُطِيقُونَ. And he does not give order of sharia which people would not be normally be able to carry out. لَا يُكَلِّفُ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِلَّا وُسْعَهَا. Allah does not give responsibility to any nafs except according to its own capabilities. وَلَا يُعَاقِبُهُمْ زِيَادَةً عَلَىٰ مَا يَسْتَحِقُّونَ. And عَرَاب will not go beyond what people deserve. وَلَا يُقَابِلُ مُسْتَحِقُّ الْأَجْرِ وَالثَّوَابِ بِأَلِيمِ الْعَذَابِ وَالْعِقَابِ وَأَنَّهُ تَعَالَى لَمْ يُجْبِرْ عِبَادُهُ عَلَى الْأَفْعَالِ سِيَمَ الْقَبِيحَةِ وَيُعَاقِبُهُمْ عَلَيْهَا. Allah does not make people majboor, does not force them to commit any act, especially the evil acts, and then to go and say that now I will punish you. This is the comprehensive meaning of adl as we leave it, and it is wajib for us to understand that adl is not just to say khuda insaaf ki che julamgar nahi, and then because we don't go into the depth, and the depth is still to come, because after this I will discuss and I'll let you know how many new points arose among the Muslims. How many things came in? How Aimma alayhim salam answered? And in what places? Because we as laymen, we mix up two things. We mix up qaza and qadr and adl. Qaza, qadr is something else. And adl is something else. Qaza, qadr means, suppose the destiny, something happened, adab came, bala came, qada wa qadr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has got his own ways. We mix these two things together. For example, my rizq. My rizq is qadr, measured. My umr, that is my life, is qadr, measured. Right? These things are different from adl. That is why when Imam Jafar Sadiq salawatullahi wasallam was asked when qada wa qadr, he said, is a man free agent or is he majboor? It was related to qada wa qadr, not to adl. Imam al-Islam told him, stand up. He stood up. Imam al-Islam told him, lift your one foot. He lifted his foot. Imam al-Islam said, now in this very situation, as you are standing with one foot held up, lift the other foot. Lift the other. Your own foot, your own leg. You already held it once. You are only standing on one leg. Try to lift the other. He said, Mawla, this cannot happen. Even if we try, we cannot do it. Imam al-Islam said, this is the degree of jabr and this is the degree of ikhtiyar. In certain cases in qada or qadr, you have got ikhtiyar, that means free will to an extent, and to an extent, no. This is an evidence within your own existence. So we are mixing up so many things together when we think. So inshallah ta'ala, in the lectures to come, qada or qadr will be discussed separately. This is adl ilahi, where Allah's adl means that he would, whatever he, whatever adl and aql demands, adl being a truth, an absolute truth, Allah orders accordingly. Kullama hakama bihi al-aql hakama al-shara'. Whatever aql has ruled, sharia follows, because aql is an absolute truth. And adl itself also is an absolute truth. Al-haqiqatu mustaqillatu. It's haqiqa which is mustaqil. That means it has got its own existence. It is not to say that Allah is majboor about it or anything. No, it's actually because Allah is hakim. وَفِعْلُ الْحَكِيمُ لَا يَخْلُ عَنِ الْحِكْمَةِ. The fa'l of hakim does not be devoid of hikmah. I hope that we stop at this, and then inshallah next Saturday, if we get time, we will discuss one, two debates more, to tell you how the ulama were misled and how Ahlul Bayt al-Muslim tried to save it. And then we will come to qada wa qadr, we will come to the sufferings, we will come to all those points later on inshallah. Now if you have any points raised, arising from this particular dissertation that I have presented today, please ask for further clarifications. Or apart from that, if you have any masail related to any fiqh, ask so that we have a useful exchange and dialogue. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi. Yes.
I'm sorry to labor on this point, but Jabr and Ikhtiyar, the impression, is it possible to allow the
As I said, Jabr and Ikhtiyar means because arising from the debate that they originally had, you were a bit late, Rasneen. We were going on through this, what happened between Asha'ira and Mu'tazila. Because they believe that Adl, although they are believing in Adl, I said this earlier that even Sunnis believe in Adl, but the only Adalat they believe is in that whatever Allah does is Adl. It's not that Allah does according to Adl. So the corollary was that they had to believe in that everything that a human being does is destined. That this comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is called Jabr. And we said no, there is something like irada, there is something like will. When a person comes to do something, he does it by his will. And he is a free will. That means he can avoid what he is doing and he can indulge in what he does by his own free will. That is called Jabr Ikhtiyar as far as this is concerned. And as far as Jabr Ikhtiyar as far as Qada and Qadr is concerned, that will be discussed later, where to say whether a man has to live according to the age limited by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or is it in the hands of man to prolong his life. Risk, whether he will get his provision, whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has willed, or is it possible for him to earn more risk, and things like that, they'll become later. Yes.
And I understand it. Which Allah himself has taught us. Which is part of his knowledge. Which is part of his existence. And we are to understand by that reference to know himself evidently. So that we can test the concept of Allah by reference to those truths which he has taught. And to that extent, it is an indication of what he does, without actually setting out the parameters of what he can do. You know. Secondly, I don't understand. This is to confirm my understanding. Secondly, what is this point about relative adala? Is this the point about relative adala in relative circumstances, or is it to do with absolute circumstances?
No, they can't be absolute circumstances. Second, if you talk of the whole, if you talk of absolute, then there is no circumstance. When we talk of circumstance, there is nothing like absolute. Because they believe that things are evil according to Zaman and Makan. That is a relative. Now let us take an example today in the West. Dancing. Now dancing in Western society is something for which they don't even think that it is bad. I mean, to tell them it is haram or what is something else, they don't even consider it as bad. Right? They recommend it. It is fine art to them. And the boys and girls will be told to go into a class. To us, it is totally a bomb. Drinking. Christianity today, of all the tragedies that we have, Christianity itself tells that to drink in certain measure is all right. But to us, it is Gunahe Kabira. So now you can see that living in a contemporary age, good and evil has got so many interpretations. Take more examples for our own society. There was a time, and I remember when I was young, to enter Imam Bara without a cap. Oof. That was a problem, because any elder, not necessarily my father, any elder would just tell me, go home, put a cap, you know you are an Imam Bara. You have come without a cap. Don't you feel ashamed? So we used to go home, and sometimes when we knew that we were going to Imam Bara, we would put a cap in our pocket, small cap, Arabic cap. And just as we entered Imam Bara, we donned it on our heads, so that no elder would tell us that you have come. Today, it is the other way around. Today, it is the one wearing a cap who is an old man out. Is it not so? And even those who don't wear cap, of course, they're committing no sin. And I remember my father telling me that if any young boy wore glasses in those days, I mean, I'm talking of his days now, then his father would be approached by all the elders. Why is your son wearing glasses? Is there something wrong, or is he just wearing for fashion? If it is for fashion, tell him to remove. And in my own lifetime, in your lifetime, Hajimullah Sahib is here, Bashir is here, many others. There was a time when any boy, if he was seen drinking tea in the hotel, then his proposal to anybody's daughter was impossible. Yes. See, among the things that, for reasons even for refusal, would be in hotel mein chai piye. Yes, yes, it's true. How can you give to a person who drinks tea in the hotels now? And there was a time. Now, what was good then? Was it bad then? Has it become good today? So these are the arguments which Ash'ari gave, that good and evil is relative. Do you understand? What we are telling them is this, that these goods are not the goods and evils we are discussing. We are not discussing these goods and evils. We are discussing the principles. Set a standard first, and after having set a standard, accept the loyalty to a particular standard, and based on that standard, then decide what is good, what is bad. Because it is quite possible that in those days when our elders thought that wearing a cap was a necessity, it was not necessary, but well, they thought it. Shariat never said it. Today, wearing it or not wearing it has become irrelevant. So we want to have a standard. And by that standard, then we will say that now this is good and this is bad. It's absolutely necessary. That is the reason why, if you know, many people ask that if people are good, they may not be mu'min, they may not be Muslim, they may not have iman, but they are good people. They are giving charities, they are giving all this, they are working. Why should they not be going to Jannah? My answer.
Thank you, Yang Quran. It's not sahih.
If it contradicts from you.
There is an ayat in the Quran that says, we have made all the sea games halal for you. All the sea games, all the water games halal for you. And we have a hadith that says we should not eat the fish without the scales. On this I have granted all seeking.
Does not say all which I have. The ayat says, أُحِلَّتْ لَكُمْ صَيْدُ الْبَحْرِ. Halal is for you the hunting that you carry out from the sea. Does not mean all. And therefore, what happens is this, that in order to know the difference between contradiction is, as I said last time, if you remember, that what is the contradictory term for black? Somebody said white. Huh? I said it's not so. What about green then? What about blue? The contradictory term for black is not white. The contradictory term for black is not black. Similarly, the contradictory term for white is not white. This is called naqir. If Allah had said that all is halal, then if the Prophet had said that these are the exceptions, then it would be naqir. But if Allah says that the hunt or the food that is to get by hunting from the sea is halal, then if the Prophet has said that they must have scales, that means he has qualified the order. Qualifying an order does not make naqir or contradiction. Contradiction is when it goes directly against it. So let us be very careful. It's not contradiction, it is a qualification. It's a qualification that while Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us that you may eat, then Rasulullah tells us, yes, the meaning is that you will eat from it fish carrying scales. A qualifying hadith does not contradict. Contradiction is yes and no. Then of course it's a contradiction.
Yes, sir. Talking about Mihraj, I've heard that our ulamas believe that Rasulullah did not go on Mihraj once, but several times. Can you throw some light?
Yes, this is true. You are right there that ulama have written, and one of the ulama who have written is Sahib al-Mizan, the Fasir of al-Mizan. Of course, the first Mihraj which we normally celebrate on 27 was took place in Makkah, before Hijrah. After Hijrah from Medina, there were several Mi'raj. But the Mi'raj about which the Prophet spoke so very openly and so very, with so much of detail, is this Mi'raj that took place before Medina. That is why that hadith which has been reported from Aisha, that Rasulullah went to Mi'raj from my room, and when he came back, the bed was still warm, does not hold any water, because Aisha came to the Prophet's house in Medina, and Mi'raj took place to Mecca. At that time, Aisha was not still married. So in any case, there have been several Mi'raj, but the Mi'raj that we know of, which probably the Prophet talks of openly and so much of detail, is this one. Ulama have written that story.
Yes. So talking again about this Mi'raj, I want to clarify something. What about this curtain thing? Is that right or is that also wrong?
Where is that curtain? I do not know. Because I will tell you, I always read Sahib al-Mizan. I know that the tafsir that I rely upon, for example, is al-Mizan of Sayyid Fatima. Or I take the earliest one, which is Majmu'ul Bayan. Right? Or earlier than that also, is the Bayan of Shaftusi. Right? I go there and I take Qur'an with me. I take this. Qur'an does not talk of any curtain, whether it was made of silk or cotton. No. But Qur'an talks clearly about the Prophet having gone وَدَنَا فَتَدَلَّا وَقَانَ قَابُ أَوْسَيْنِ أَوْ أَدْنَا. He came, he bent himself, he bowed down and he became closer. And that's all. We do not know of any curtain. And then there was no need of any curtain because there was nobody hiding from him. I mean, this concept of curtain has become fashionable because behind it there was something. People believe that God was sitting there. Some believe that there was a lion sitting there. Some say that that lion was Imam Ali. Some say that that lion came out and the Prophet was terrified when he saw that lion. And Jibreel told him, don't be afraid, give him your ring. And he gave him his ring, and the second day the ring was given back by Imam Ali. No, all these things are not true. Let us be very careful. Yes, sir. Buraq. Buraq comes from Barq. Barq means electricity. Barq means anything that is driven by light. And Buraq is a superlative degree. It means abundance of light, or maybe abundance of light. And I personally, when I thought this earlier, I was very young, I never knew just what it should be. Because the member ulama told us it was like a small donkey. The heads of donkey and the ears of the horses and things like that. And even today we hear these things. But it is clear there that it was Buraq. And for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to have gone and come back within the part of the night to the end of the universe and come back on that vehicle, which vehicle was of light, electricity, makes more sense than calling it a donkey or a small horse. See, it was, I believe, a power that came to collect him, whether it came as electricity or came as light, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Perhaps in those days people could not understand, they were given such versions. But today, after having known that, and the name so significantly Buraq, which is superlative form of Barq,
you have mentioned rightly that you refer to Al-Mizan of Tabatabai or Tibyan or Shabuzi or Matna or Bayan. But what happens as there is a danger, as you know, I mean, people interpret Kursi or Arsh as a throne, different meaning. Then we have these interpreters coming in, and yet we are told in the Quran that whoever misinterprets or interprets the Quran the way he thinks it should be interpreted is sometimes in a very grave position to commit a mistake or commit error interpreting, and he is carrying a responsibility on his shoulders if he does it. You see. Now how do you draw a line? You have this interpreter who wants to do a tafsir, and yet he comes across two verses. One is muhkamat, and then you have mutashabihat. Now those mutashabihat, I said, you do not ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His own wisdom. You cannot question certain things. You cannot throw light upon it. How do these interpreters go about actually interpreting mutashabihat? Do they do it as it should be done? Because Allah commands that you are not to know, to comprehend certain aspects, certain things in the Quran. How do you explain this?
First of all, for any translation, for any commentary on the tafsir, it must be understood that whoever wants to carry out a tafsir must be a qualified person. And I insist upon this, that this qualification is not a minimum. One has got to have a maximum qualification. Quran Majeed has got so many conditions. One cannot just go into translation and come to the meaning of it. The ulama who wrote, for example, like Sayyid Muhammad Hussain Tawakabai, who wrote Al-Mizan, or the earlier ones, they were masters in Arabic language, masters of kalam, masters of falsafa, masters of contemporary thoughts, masters of so many significant things. Allama Hilli alayhi rahma used to say that we must know 90 ulum before we start writing tafsir. Now we just believe like this, that is it a shame to be able to go and refer to the book before saying that this is what Allah has said? Why should one say and take a responsibility? It's not a shame to refer to the ulama who know. Yes, the only thing that we can complain about is that those good books are not in our hands in English or in Urdu or in Gujarati for everyone of us to read and benefit from. That complaint is genuine. Or that we can't read. But on the other hand, those things have been mentioned. And our ulama have known into every, and if you look in Usul al-Kafi, you find that there is a chapter where our Imam Ali Muslim explained all the ayat, like Kursi or Arsh, all these things. You see, that is there. And those who left Ahlul Bayt, of course, they have come with new version. For example, when I was young, my tutor was a Sunni. He used to say, وَرَبُّ الْعَرْشِ فَوْقَ الْعَرْشِ وَلَكِنْ بِدُونِ الْإِتِّصَالِ, that the Lord of Arsh is sitting on Arsh without touching the throne. That means he's touching, he's not touching, but he's sitting. وَرَبُّ الْعَرْشِ فَوْقَ الْعَرْشِ. You see, these are the things they were teaching us. Of course, we knew that when we were students, so we had to learn from them many good things. With them, we used to learn these things. And in our case, Imam Muhammad Baqir, salawatullah, 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 and all the Imam, even Imam Zahradi, as early as that, Imam Ali al-Islami al-Najibullah, he has explained this. Now, you see, it's clear. Of course, we are not supposed to tafsir according to, but there is no hujjat for anyone to do tafsir of anything without having the full dream about it. It's just like sitting to write a commentary on Shakespeare without knowing English literature.
But then how do you draw a line when you have three very competent ulama who have interpreted in three different ways?
That is all right.
I mean, how do you...
That's okay. You see, when there are three ulama who are interpreted in three various ways, you may select anyone you like, then you are selecting on a hujjah. This is very important. This is like taqlid. You are selecting on somebody who has had an authority and this is his version. You may accept it. But not our own coined one or fabricated. Or saying, I believe this is the meaning of it. It's not what I believe. Because sometimes we try to take the meaning which suits us.
What do you say of the ayah that you are not to know about a certain of an ayah? Allah in his own wisdom knows best why.
Where, which is that ayah?
That he knows best. There are certain things you are not to ask because you cannot comprehend it.
I have not come across any ayah for Quran Majid. I have come across an ayah where Allah says, لَا تَسْعَلُوا عَنْ أَشْيَاءَ إِن تُبْدَ لَكُمْ تَسُؤْكُمْ. Don't ask about things. If the answer were revealed to you, it will harm you. That I have seen, but not about Quran. About mutashabihat, what Allah says is that despite it being mutashabihat, people try to follow it on its apparent meaning and mislead. That of course is so. So what Allah wants us to understand is that we should go into its inner meaning. But it does not say that you don't ask. Yes.
You said that in Quran, Allah says that he took Rasul from to do Mi'raj, to visit his okay, his signs. So why, I've got two questions on that. Why Allah has to take him back many times? I've heard that he did more than 100 times. I don't know if it's true. And the other thing is, when Rasul himself has said that Salat is a mihraj for mu'min, so what does that mean?
Salat is a mihraj for mu'min is a figurative speech, is a metaphorical speech. When we pray for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is mihraj for mu'min, that means it's an elevation, it's an enhancement for a mu'min. Gets closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, provided he prays with attention. That is a figurative, metaphorical. But as far as the Prophet having gone, whether 100 times or less or more, the question why is something very interesting. Do I have a right to ask you why you call somebody as your guest 10 times? Your own wish. If Allah, I cannot tell you why, but if Allah has summoned or called the Prophet more than one time, it's grace. I mean, there cannot be why for it. I mean, it is his will. He called him 100 times, 100 times, 5 times, 5 times, once only, once. You see, that can be, the more you love a guest, the more often you call him. So that is not a question which I can answer why. But I can tell you that Mi'rajul Mu'min, that Salat is there, is a metaphorical speech, is a figurative speech. It doesn't mean that if I start praying, then I should be sent up to the seventh heaven to visit the Arsh and to see. Yes.
They don't say Bismillah in the second surah. We are allowed to pray Namaz in Jamaat now. According to our faith, we are allowed to pray in Jamaat now.
We are allowed to pray Namaz in Jamaat with them, provided we read our own surahs. And they don't read. Mi'rajul Mu'min, the Salat is there, is a metaphorical speech, is a figurative speech. It doesn't mean that if I start praying, then I should be sent up to the seventh heaven to visit the Arsh and to see. Yes.
They don't say Bismillah in the second surah. We are allowed to pray Namaz in Jamaat now. According to our faith, we are allowed to pray Jamaat now.
We are allowed to pray Namaz in Jamaat with them, provided we read our own surahs. And they don't read Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim in any surahs. Not only second surah, but only Alhamdulillah, they don't. If you go to Makkah, Medina, some of them do not. In some firqa of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, Bismillah is read silently. But in some, like Hanafi and even the Shafi'i, they don't read Bismillah even for Alhamdulillah. You'll find them, Allahu Akbar, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. And they don't read second surah complete, but they read certain ayats. For them, a complete surah is not necessary. Certain verses of Quran is enough, and without Bismillah. When you are following Ahl Sunnah Imam, whether in Makkah or anywhere, you will read your own surah with Bismillah for both. Yes, Muhammad Taqi.
Is it possible that there have been more than many Adams before Adam has been believing? Because in the Quran, when Allah says that I want to create Adam and send him as a Khalifa, and Jibreel, one of the agents, told Allah so that they may kill each other and spill blood.
Yes. Now, there's no question of giving you a possibility, because Mawla Ali ibn Talib has said this, and all the Imams have said. So there's no possibility, it's a fact, it has been substantiated by our Imam alayhi wasalam, that there have been many Adams before our Adam. There have been many Adams before. So as far as being Adam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Quran Majeed talks of this Adam, who is the father of us all. According to a hadith that we know, there have been many Adams before, and there can be many Adams after. So, there is no such question as we are the only ones. This Adam may be about 10 to 20,000 years old. There have been Adams before this, and Hazrat Ali al-Islam has said this, that there have been Adam before you. So there is an indication already there.
Can there be two Adams at the same time? Because there is a vast universe.
There can be, yes. Why?
So there could be parallel.
There is an indication when once Imam al-Islam said, and other Imam al-Islam said, that do you know that there are so many members of this universe, and they also have their own life, the way you have your own lives, and they live, and they have had their own Adam, and they have had their own Hujjat. And once Imam al-Islam said that among the Hujjats they have, we are also the Hujjats upon them, the same way as we are Hujjats upon you. So we have got all these things in our hadith.
Well, that's a question of Madan. One of the things that is rather contemporary at the moment is the discussion about slavery. Now, if you consider the history of Islam, all those things which were considered to be atrocious and bad were prohibited,
yes,
either gradually or in some degree. It seems if you consider slavery, it has been institutionalized. Now, one of the answers that automatically one gives is that Allah actually changed the character of slavery by imposing obligations on the master, of such sort that it was no longer slavery of an oppressive sort. But nevertheless, is the concept of slavery one that Islam condones, even in its modified form? Or is it one that is left, is it something that should have been, that would have, that Allah has decided to kind of let it disappear by itself?
Well, this has got nothing to do with adalat, first of all, let me tell you that. Because we are discussing the adalat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah did not say that you must have slaves. But let me tell you one thing, the only answer I can give you is this, that if you look into our fiqh, we claim that our fiqh covers every aspect of life. True? If you take the whole fiqh, jurisprudence, you will not find any order or any laws pertaining to purchase of slaves. But you will find about the sale of slaves. You will find Babul Itq. Babul Itq you will find, that means how to free the slaves. Babul Riq, how to free the slaves. But you will not find how to buy a slave. That means there has been no such guidance on giving money in lieu of the slaves. Why? Because that was something which was not at all promulgated. Secondly, if you look at kafaras and things that have been as penalties or whatever have been put in, you will find that we have so many orders where it is recommended to free. So of course it was obnoxious, but the way Islam dealt with it was a gradual disappearance of it, which took place as time went by. And not only that, it also changed its nature in a sense, that from slavery it became servitude, or rather being a servant of someone, not a slave of someone. Secondly, by recommending intermarriages between housemaids and servants and slaves and the free people, Islam brought in a new generation where one parent was a slave, another parent was a free man, and the children born were all free. So this is how Islam has worked on it. And I think that gradually whatever happened is of course due to Islam. Now if you look at the way it's been portrayed in history generally, I believe that the Arabs, although they must be guilty of having carried out slavery, but more than Arabs, it was the Western world which not only provided the market for it, but which also imported not only thousands but millions of them as slaves. But they would like to always ascribe it to Arabs, and through Arabs to Islam. But that is not an Islamic way of life. So, if at all you find any incidents of purchase in Islamic history, if at all, where there has been a purchase or a particular slave has been bought, you will find that it is immediately for the sake of emancipation and free. Like, the common thing is Zayd, who is the Prophet's son, I mean adopted son. When he came, Janabi Khadija bought him over during that time. He was 8 years old. The Prophet immediately asked Khadija to sell him unto himself. The Prophet purchased him, bought him from him, giving him whatever she had paid. And he emancipated him immediately. Said, "You are a free one and you are now my son." Or Janabi Najis Khatun, as we hear that she wasn't a slave, but she was a captive. She was a captive in a war. But the moment they sold the captives against ransoms, the moment ransom was paid, they were freed. And things like that happen in Islam. Unless you have any other point, I find that this was the safest way of dealing with one of the thorny questions in those days, because slavery had already been interlinked with the economy of the times.
It seems to me that if we were to discuss with the Christians at the moment about this particular point, it would be fair to say that Islam did not outright prohibit slavery. And that would be a fact.
But it did not encourage the purchase.
It encouraged
the purchase for the sake of emancipation. But the chapter of release and the chapter of emancipation is there. Babul Itq and Babul Riq. In any fiqh book you'll find it is there.
Why did Islam, in the rules of war, did not take the opportunity of actually saying all the captives will not be treated as slaves? I mean, when there was a war fought after the time of the Holy Prophet.
no one was taken as a slave, they were taken as prisoners of war. And the prisoners of war are not released against price, they are released against ransom.
So there, not, there was no incidence of slavery.
On the contrary, there is a Quran ayat, O Prophet, don't take them as slaves. Because the people around advised the Prophet that just take them as slaves. There is an ayah of Quran, so don't take them as slaves. Captives.
Nevertheless, Islam still basically gave that approval of slavery. Now, when you look at Adalah, you say that this is not a question of Adalah. And yet what is absolute good is absolute good, what is absolute bad is absolute bad. I'm sure to compare. You say it was interwoven in the economic system. But so are many other things which were immediately prohibited. Why slavery was given an exception?
Well, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not commend or even recommend or praise slavery. You don't find any hadith in Islam which praises slavery or recommends slavery. And this is the reason why I consider that famous hadith of the Prophet as the final ruling, where he said, "Kullukum min Adam, wa Adam min Turab." All of you are from Adam, and Adam is from dust. وَلَا فَخْرَ لِلْعَرَبُ عَلَى الْعَجَمُ. And there is no fakhr or pride for Arab or the non-Arab. Ajam means all non-Arabs. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. And the most honorable in the eyes of God is the one who fears him. I consider this as the principle which tells the masses clearly that there is no question of slavery or not. I must also draw one attention, Hasnain, when we read in Arabic, so-and-so Mawla Fulan, so-and-so Mawla of Fulan. Many have translated this as slave. Well, that Mawla does not always mean slave. You'll be very careful when you read it from Arabic. This is the reason why there was an article written by one very good learned scholar that so many slaves were there in Karbala because they have been misled by the word Mawla. For example, they used to say so-and-so Mawla so-and-so. And they believe that this Mawla means slave. It's not so. Sometimes and quite often, Mawla means one tribe having sworn oath of fidelity or oath of brotherhood with wilaya, with another tribe. So I become your Mawla, you become my Mawla. And many Mawla have been taken as slaves, which were not true. Acha, there was a class of people in Arabia who, after having got themselves attached to the Prophet, or to Ahlul Bayt, refused to be emancipated. Refused to be emancipated not because they were treated as slaves and they wanted to remain associated with the household because they were treated as equals. By action, right from the Prophet till our 11th Imam, I see in history that no slave has been treated as a slave. This is something which gives me a hint that there has been no recommendation to say that in certain time this evil became good. I don't see anywhere in history that this evil has not become good anywhere as far as the Masumin are concerned. As far as the others are concerned, Quran Majid says, now this ayat of Nikah that we are reading, what does it say? وَنْكِحُ الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ. Ayama means whom? Slave girls.
Yes.
It comes from Amma. وَأَنْكِحُ الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ وَالصَّالِحِينَ مِنْ عِبَادِكُمْ. Who are there? So actually, if you look at the original Quran and Hadith, you will not find it recommended. Of course, what happened in the environment there, the eradication took place with the act and with the speech of the Prophet of God. I always maintain that La ilaha illallah itself was a revolutionary dictum. And I give an example that what was the position of Bilal immediately after La ilaha illallah. Bilal was a slave of Mughayrah. From Mughayrah he was bought over by Abu Bakr. After he said La ilaha illallah, the Prophet gave the money to Abu Bakr. Said, go and purchase him. Purchase him for the sake of emancipation, because he would not give him away. And when he was bought over and he came, he was emancipated. Now suddenly a black man who was a slave till yesterday is emancipated. But there is one thing which happened while Mughirah was still the master. When he heard that Bilal says La ilaha illallah, he called him. Now, in a meeting that was arranged, Abu Sufyan was sitting there. And not only Abu Sufyan was sitting, Abu Jahl was sitting there. And Mughira says, Bilal, I understand that you have started saying La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. He said, yes. He said, are you prepared to believe in one God, leaving all these 360 that we have? Which is better, having one or having many? Bilal said, only one. He said, then what is the difference between you and me? He said, since I have said La ilaha illallah, you and I are now equal. You and now, I are now equal. For a slave who is still a slave, to say this, this was an idea, that what the Prophet ﷺ said was, of course, a revolution in the minds of the people. But in history, it might have taken some time to be eradicated. That's true. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, saw that this went into sort of an evolutionary process. But there was no such recommendation or no commendation of this particular act to say, as in Adl, that this particular evil was meant to seem good. I don't see anywhere.
So the explanation here, I think, is that institution of slavery was started during the time of Jahiliyyah, before the Arabs became Muslims, and the Prophet ﷺ came to emancipate it. I mean, one could even sort of explain it.
Yes, the only thing people want is that he should have emancipated it by just stroke of pen like that, which he did not do. He did it in this way, because there was a lot of problem. Now, I appeal to you to just consider today how it is easy to say La ilaha illallah. How easy it is to say La ilaha illallah. But I say that simply for having said La ilaha illallah, the Prophet to be stoned, to be hit, to be subjected to all the problems, it gives me sometimes a time to think that perhaps there was something more. That the moment La ilaha illallah was proclaimed, the whole system started shaking. Everything shook. You see, so I think that is how the Prophet arranged it. Of course, there's no doubt that the slavery had been inherited in that society because it came from Jahiliyyah. And because the media is in their hands, the books are printed in English, and they are spread all over that it was Islam that started this. No, that's not true.
Was the Arab economy such at that time, as Allah had said, stroke of slavery, stroke of a pen, would the economy have disintegrated?
In fact, there was no such very hard and fast economy. It was such that slaves were themselves a commodity. It was not like America, where slavery formed a labor force for working on the farms.
If you compare that with oil today, we're told, don't use oil anymore, the economy would disintegrate straight away. Now, would that kind of thing have happened then, if they said...
I should think so, but no, I am not very clear, because I have not studied it so deeply. But I should think so, that there must have been some economical involvement. Any other masala? Next Saturday, if we meet, inshallah ta'ala, there are some ifs and buts to everything. But if I don't go for my eye operation, then we are meeting. If I go for my eye operation, then we might not see that. But I'm trying to cancel my appointment with the NHS. But I have got a cataract in my eyes, as you know, and I cannot read now properly. But if I go for operation, then I'll be going on Wednesday, and I will not be available for 12, 15 days, so it will be okay. But if I don't go, and I'm trying not to, so that the month of Ramadan passes, then we are meeting next, inshallah, for further discussion on adala, which is very important. I have been requesting that we write, not that we will forget, but Alhamdulillah, Muhammad Rida is taping it, and it is being recorded. please take this tape. These are the most important tapes. These are the tapes which should be in our library. Listen to them again and again. This is our faith, and it is being treated in a scholastic way. This is how our ulama have treated it. Each line has got a meaning in it. And please keep these tapes with you and listen to them again and again, because they are really very useful tapes, inshallah ta'ala. And the discussion comes again. And he has got a full set Tawheed. I think all of them are there, isn't it?
Yes, yeah.
And after Tawheed is Adala. The Adala will go on for about 6 to 7 sessions by the time we come to the conclusion, and then we'll go to Nubuwwah to understand what is Wahi and what is Nabi. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum.
And inshallah we pray for your complete success of the operation.
Yes,